there and then, because they are using it. You see, many people, Trevor, yeah. are living by the day.
Yeah.
They have no luxury to do banking. So when you are trying to do your small things in the construction industry, and then you cannot access cash from the bank without too much explanation, you would rather just keep your cash. I think what the president has done, the people he has entrusted to look at these regulations,
yeah.
they must look at it, and in my own proposal, it will be 5 million. 5 million shillings, you know? There are up to 5 million shillings you can bank, you can withdraw and do what you want to do. That will bring money into circulation.
Okay.
A lot of people are keeping money in houses, yeah? And they are reluctant because they don't want too many questions. And governments, by their very definition, their work is to give services.
Okay.
Provide water, provide roads, provide electricity, provide healthcare. It is not to get into the nitty-gritty okay. of people's personal life. People are very private by nature.
Yeah.
And it's not that they are crooks or they are doing anything wrong.
Yeah, because this capping was meant to curb corruption.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Illicit
A lot of people with hardware shops, they raise money up to 1 million, 1.5, 2 million on a daily basis, doing clean business. Yeah. Yet now, when they take it to the bank, they have to sit down, explain, why are you bringing it in cash? Why couldn't you do an RTGS? And the explanation is, the people who bought from me bought in cash.
Yeah.
You know, this will help a lot. And I think it's a timely intervention.
Yeah.
And once the capping is done right, you will see instant results
yeah.
in terms of
cash flow.
You know, it will be within 3 months, there will be money in circulation. People will start bringing money to the bank. And that money will be available for own lending to other people. Because when you keep this money, the house is not helping anybody. Number two, the issue of CRB, the president is spot on. You know, Trevor, we have brought the Fuliza economy.
Yeah.
You know, Kenyans are not able to borrow from the banks because the interest rates are very exorbitant. The requirements are very stringent, and people have been borrowing from Fuliza. I was in Mombasa, and a taxi driver was telling me they borrow money from Fuliza to put fuel in their taxi, then they get no customers, then they cannot pay, they are blacklisted on CRB, and small amounts,
yeah.
you know, 5,000, 10,000, and a man's life comes to a standstill. So I think this intervention by the president is very, very, very realistic, that small amounts that have been borrowed cannot be put, you know, subject,
yeah.
you know, to very serious regulatory inhibitions.
Yeah.
You know, we need to let people grow and borrow freely without too much.
Yeah.
So I think the window that he has given is
yeah.
good because it will allow people to borrow further. Because you may borrow today, and what you borrow to do did not work, then you cannot borrow next week, then you close shop. But you may borrow today, you are not able to pay, you borrow tomorrow, the day after, and you are able to sort out the initial issue that made you not pay. So I think freeing the money market and letting it operate freely, you know, on the law of demand and supply, and letting it operate in a way that people feel comfortable
yeah.
about their financial transactions,
okay.
where there is not too much policing into people's lives. You know, it will increase cash injection, and it will free money supply, it will increase trade,
yeah.
and eventually,
yeah.
you know, KRA will be able to pick tax.
Okay.
You know, and this revenue will go a long way
yeah.
in assisting the government to offer services to the people of Kenya.
Okay.
Yeah.
Governor Mutua, many people are saying that this is time for politicians to withdraw more money and run around campaigning.
No, I think it's timely. This thing, I think people have been listening to this show.
Yeah.
Because I have been talking about this basically every week, talking about bureaucracy, talking about lack of money in circulation, talking about expanding, enabling people to withdraw money,
yeah.
talking about the 1 million shilling, the requirements. I've given examples here of how young people have lost opportunities because once they are paid, they couldn't withdraw money to move chap chap to invest that money somewhere else when opportunities arose. I've been talking about it for a long time. It has been a very, very bad policy, if I may say that. I can see where it came from, thinking about money laundering, thinking about terrorism and others, but it's pushing too much. A million shillings is a lot of money. But in terms of international trade, it's what you call just $10,000.
Yeah.
It's basically a drop in the ocean when you think about circulation of money and things that people are doing.
Yeah.
Mheshimiwa Gachagua said very well, you're a farmer, you've grown, you've worked hard, uko na ngombe zako, umeenda umeuza ngombe. You know that you've, my running mate here talked about, you know, and you go, you've got 5 million shillings. You cannot bank that money. Umetoa wapi? Tuoneshe evidence hiyo ngombe. Ya ngombe ilikuwa inaitwa nani? Hiyo ngombe ilitoneshe picha. Can we see documents? Hiyo safari. You know, all those people have been keeping money under their mattresses. And you say there's no money in circulation. The economy has tanked as a result of this policy of making it difficult for money to circulate. And it is not good economics, because a person who really understands growing an economy thinks about expanding the economic base, thinks about collecting taxes, thinks about getting money moving around. Watu waseme kuna pesa. Mimi kila asubuhi watu wananitisha pesa. Unasikia ukiuliza mtu hali ya mambo, anasema eh, kumnimesota. Siku hizi bwana hakuna pesa. Watu wananiambia siku ya Kibaki kulikuwa na pesa. During Kibaki's days, there was money.
Yeah.
How come there's no money now? You know, it's because of certain policies that make it difficult for people to spend money, withdraw money in a chap-chap manner, so that money can circulate and people get jobs. You cannot talk about you want to grow the economy in this country, that you want to remove unemployment, you have to get jobs, create jobs, if I cannot be able to access my money to do something that pays somebody very quickly so they have money in their pocket. You cannot. Whenever there's a delay, people suffer. Now, the withdrawal and the banking of money, I agree, a 5 million cap is a good cap. Even 10 million shillings is a good cap, 10 million shillings. When you think about the value of money today, the million shillings that you have today does not have the same intrinsic value that it had 5 years ago during Kibaki's days.
Yeah.
It has changed, the cost of living has gone up. So 10 million today is basically what a million was 10, 15 years ago. So it's not much money. So we also have to be realistic in terms of where are we. Let the investigative agencies, kama watu wameiba pesa, and they are going to withdraw the money or give the money, let the investigative agencies follow the money and arrest those people. 98% of Kenyans are good people. They don't steal, they are not in politics, they are not in government, they are not, 98% of Kenyans are just hardworking people. So you cannot put a policy to restrict 1 or 2% and end up hurting everybody in the country.
Yeah.
So we'll let the agencies, kama mtu ameiba, afuatwe.
Yeah.
Wacho wafanye kazi yao. Like, let's open the economy to majority people. When it comes to CRBs, the same thing. You know, you're listing people, you're making it life difficult. You know, this COVID time,
yeah,
people started businesses and then COVID hit. I opened my hotel, you know, and then I built my hotel, the bank loan is there, COVID hit. What do I do? You know, I need to do that. I'm lucky that, you know, I have a financial institution that understands and that give leeway. A lot of people opened a kiosk, somebody opened a salon, somebody opened a small supermarket, COVID hit. You know, curfew ikaingia, unafunga saa mbili. Saa moja, saa tatu, nenda nyumbani. You're not able to recoup your money to pay back. Then you're listed. Though you cannot borrow money to actually, you know, jumpstart whatever you started so you can pay back the loan.
Yeah.
So what does that mean? It means that the people who are owed money will never be paid money. Umeona hiyo shida? So this is not just about the people who have borrowed. It's also the people who have been owed money, the banks. The banks have been put in a situation whereby they will never be paid.
Yeah.
Because this person has actually been crippled kabisa. Amechimbiwa chini na amezikwa na amefunikwa akiwa hai. They'll never be able to lift up their heads. So some of these things are good. They are coming in a bit too late. We've been talking about them for 2 years, 2-3 years now. And it's all about shifting the mentality from the top to think about what is it that is affecting Mwananchi in a way that you can do 20% that affects 80% of the country.
Okay. Omatangi?
Yes, Trevor. I think three things I would say quickly on the three aspects. First, I think we isolate the issue of the Kazi Mtaani initiative for what it is. I think it's important that we let our viewers know that, you know, when you have an economy like the one we have, and then you have the situation like COVID that we have, part of sound economics or economic planning is that you incentivize flow and movement of cash or money within people. And one of the ways to do that is to ensure that you send money that may be held by government or institutions down to the basic to empower people to continue to buy and sell, to purchase. And that's why you find that in good economics, what then governments that are responsible and that are well planned should do is to take those tranches of money and release them under programs like Kazi Mtaani. And that's why it's important for our people to understand. You know, most of the people have said that, Trevor, because most of the people have been thinking that Kazi Mtaani is a political project or a political arrangement. It isn't. It is an economic initiative. That's what happens all over the world. If you have an economy that's dipped, send money to the people, create that, those kind of programs, people are able to go to the shop and buy and create transactions that are necessary. And number two, and probably just also so that people understand, the other incentive or initiative that is taken in that kind of scenario in proper economic planning is to have programs and projects that are big and major rolled out within areas. And that's why you find that, for example, you know, projects like the expressway, the construction of those big roads, you find, although they have been criticized a lot by people, yeah. And this is work that the governor of the central bank should have done to make sure that this message comes out to people so that our people can understand that the government is not only intending just to have grand projects that are being constructed, because yes, we agree, yeah, that some of them have been infected and plagiarized by corrupt individuals in between there. But those are incentives that are very useful to keep the economy moving, because once you have this kind of projects going, yeah, then people retain their purchasing power. I say this so that it can also be a message to our governors. You know, the cash drain system, yeah, that governors presided over, and that is of creating mountains of pending bills by mopping up little money that, yeah, people have. You give somebody a job, come and supply pens and papers and water, and then you mop up the little money that person have and fail to pay them, and then you concentrate that money and build pending bills of 100 billion, then you have disabled the masses from working. So I think that's important, so that next planning cycle, even for our county governments, when they do, is give those people those small jobs and help them to pay them so they can help your economy to be up and running. Now, secondly, is on this issue that we talked about, the 1 million shilling limit on withdrawal and transactions that we have to explain. And Trevor, I would refer to the gentleman called Bill Gates. You know him, he's one of the famous names that everybody knows. Bill Gates wrote a book, yeah, called Business at the Speed of Thought, that it is conceptualized that when you think, you can transact at that speed of that thought. That is one of the major platforms and philosophies of success.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
you say transact at the speed of thought.
Yes, the book is called Business at the Speed of Thought.
Mm-hmm.
Because you know,
don't in Kenya.
because a transaction comes to your mind,
yeah,
and you click it in your mind, and that is conceptualized at the speed by which you should be able to transact and have that business completed. And then secondly, I would be saying, Trevor, that whoever came up with this policy missed a big point, because you know it's like deciding to kill a fly with a bullet,
yeah,
or a hammer. And you find that the cost effect of implementing that is so heavy that it is not useful. You know, if you look at what has been happening, my colleagues have said that very, very well, how we resorted one into mattress banking, because that is now what has been happening.
Yeah.
But even more so, how we have successfully managed to stop transactions by creating that bureaucracy. Because it is not that the bank says that you cannot withdraw 10 million or 50 million. They say you can.
Yeah.
But it is the bureaucracy involved that does not allow the speed by which you're supposed to transact. They'll tell you, go and bring this paper, go and bring this one. Because first we created a panic and a scare. And I believe it was right to deal with, for example, the defaulters or the corporates.
Yeah.
For example, when you had people you know, stealing money from government institutions and walking into a bank in Westlands and withdrawing 200 million in one morning.
Yeah.
You know, of course, that's that's thuggery within the industry, the banking industry.
Yeah.
But that one incident should not make the entire system create such monumental barricades in a way that you can no longer be able to transact.
Yeah.
You get a small job today, Trevor, as an investor, as a businessman, and you're supposed to roll out maybe some 50 million, some 100 million payout, and you receive. And it will take you 2 weeks to satisfy the bank with the documentation. You go and bring, they say, go and bring another. Well, who is this signature? Oh, they say, we shall call them, we shall do this. And this has been the biggest problem to businesses.
Yeah.
And I think my running mate here said very well that it is not that a million shillings is little money. It is a lot of money. But in that context, it cannot be big money. I don't know what happened. There was a time we mooted the thought, and I think it should be within the central bank governance laws, that even the 1,000 shillings note has become too small now to capitalize on. You know, when it gets to safe movement of money. I mean, can you conceptualize, Trevor, that when you carry a $100 bill, a small paper like this, that you're carrying 10,000 Kenya shillings. And that's why you find that people transact, for example, like if you go around Eastleigh there, most of the transactions now in Eastleigh are in dollars, not in Kenya shillings. Because those fellows from across Somalia and wherever, they come and sell you an item and worth 10 million. They have the money in the shirt pocket, and they just remove a few dollars and it's worth your 10 million, which you have to bring in a sack, you know. So I think these are concepts that you know, a growing economy must think about for us to be able to move.
Yep.
And lastly is on this question of CRBs. I think what we would need to say to the credit reference bureaus, and I welcome that move too, is I believe that the threshold for listing must be lifted and must be readdressed.
Okay.
I mean, because you find that people are listed on that on that blacklist, sometimes for very flimsy reasons. Yes, somebody is a defaulter who has not paid the HELB loan.
Yeah.
And that person was fired from their place of work.
Because of COVID.
You know, for many reasons. It could be because of COVID or any other reason. And then they find their name in the listing of defaulters. I mean, for so many frivolous reasons, there are people who have suffered illnesses, they're servicing a loan, the guy is admitted in a hospital for a long time suffering from cancer.
Yeah.
He's unable to pay. By the time he goes to approach a bank, restructure that loan, his name is on the listing. And he's a business person who makes their life that way.
Yeah.
So I believe, you know, we have to humanize the process of that listing, especially, you know, not only for business communities, but also for people like, you know, the students and other small people. I was very surprised, and that would be my last point.
Yeah.
I visited a group in Kitengela who were having a big dispute over some people who wanted to con them of their investments in an estate. and you know, a lady there rose to tell a story.
Yeah.
And it is a lady who is who has been struggling all her life.
Yeah.
And she went to repay after finding some money to reenact a transaction she had with a bank so that she can own a home. Then she goes to Westlands, where she is referred to, and then she's told she can no longer service that facility because she has been listed as a defaulter.
Yeah.
Somebody who is living from hand to mouth somewhere in a village in Kitengela. I think that those are the things that I believe should be addressed when we're looking at
as we wind up. I'd like to hear your views on the politics parts of it, and that's coming up in just a bit. But for now, let's bring up the feedback before we wind up on this conversation, because we're running out of time here. Aparo Asiepora says, I totally agree with regarding Gachagua to the go to the recently built level 3 hospitals in slums like Mukuru, Soweto, and Kangemi. The buildings are good, but no drugs and no equipment in the labs. Okay. Njenga Wakungu says, Mheshimiwa Rigathi Gachagua, when the national government puts up health centers, it's the responsibility of the county governments to equip them, since health is a devolved service. Atanas Mavuti says, without execution, strategy and policy is useless. The president has outlined good policy to kickstart the economy, but they should be implemented to the latter for change to be seen. Chemist Anders, Kenyans have long waited for this. As they continue with their campaigns, let's use the opportunity to grind even harder, okay? Engineer Lazaro says, President Kenyatta's speech was largely focused on economic stimulus plan. He avoided mentioning corruption in his 2022 succession politics. Odongo Rolex, it's necessary to explain the source of your money, more so our leaders, since they handle a lot of public funds. Jacob Abere says, His Excellency's speech was full of goodies to ordinary people. Example, 12 package plans going to restart SMEs that had gone into ICU. And Inya Kweba says, devolving health was a million-dollar notion, but the county managers have messed everything by milking every single coin meant for health to enrich themselves. Why is it that health in some counties is working? It's all about planning. Okay.